Hello everyone, welcome to today's live broadcast, Changing the Landscape of Mass Detection in the Chromatography Lab. I'm Laura Bush, the Editorial Director of LCGC, and I'll be your moderator for today's event. We're delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by LCGC and sponsored by Waters. Waters Corporation creates business advantages for laboratory-dependent organizations by delivering scientific innovation to enable customers to make significant advancements. Waters helps customers make profound discoveries, optimize laboratory operations, deliver product performance, and ensure regulatory compliance with a connected portfolio of separations and analytical science, laboratory informatics, mass spectrometry, as well as thermal analysis. We have a few housekeeping announcements before we get started. The webcast is intended to be interactive, so we encourage you to ask questions. You can submit questions at any time by typing them in the Q&A box, and you can find that on the right-hand side of your screen. You can enlarge the slide window. Just click on the small icon in the upper right-hand corner, or you can hover your mouse over the lower right-hand corner and drag the window to the desired size. And the slides will advance automatically during the webcast. And if you have any technical problems viewing or hearing the presentation, just click on the question mark help widget in the dock at the bottom of your window. I would now like to introduce today's speaker. We're very pleased to be joined today by David Wayland, the Empower product owner at Waters. David Wayland obtained a BSc honors in applied chemistry in 1994 and joined Waters in 2000 after having worked in the pharmaceutical industry as an analytical chemist and then as a manager of a chromatography data system, or CDS, and a laboratory information system, or LIMS, for 6 years. At Waters, he has worked with the informatics suite of products in sales, consultancy, and business development across Europe and India for life science, clinical, chemical materials, food safety, food QC, and environmental testing industries. He's now part of the Global Informatics Product Management Group with responsibility for the Empower Chromatography Data System. David, thank you for joining us today. You have the floor.
Thank you, Laura, and thank you for the opportunity to present today. As I guess you probably can tell from that description of my my background, I'm more from the chromatography side as opposed to the mass spectrometry side. So really where I come from is the chromatography side of things, and getting to understand the mass spec side of things has been something that I've grown into while I've been with Waters. And essentially, one of the things that we're looking to do today is to see how the landscape of mass detection is changing within that chromatography lab, and I guess from my perspective as a chromatographer, how things are changing and how things are developing in that area. So I'd like to start really by taking a bit of a look back, and see how things were historically and see how things really started in the world of mass spectrometry. Then have a look to see how things evolved until they were where they are today, and having a look at the current landscape just to see what a chromatography lab is like today, where we're looking at some mass spectrometry and mass detection. Also going to ask the question and possibly try and answer the question about what does mass spectrometry mean to a chromatographer? So really it's as a chromatographer, what is mass spec and how does it affect me? And from my role within Waters as the Empower product owner, I'd really like to discuss how the software can be used to help people understand or people work with mass data, and maybe look at how that could develop in the future. So to start with, we'll just have a brief look at how things were in the past. So some of you who are very familiar with mass spec may take a look at this instrument and recognize it immediately. To me, this was something that was always in the realms of the mass spec specialist. It was very much a research instrument, and there were a few specialists who would work on this instrument, and there may only be a few instruments like this in any particular area, in any particular establishment. Basically, samples would arrive with the analyst, the mass spec specialist, and they would take those samples, they would work with those samples, interpret the results and the data, and pass them back to whoever requested them. Or it could be that the scientists themselves are working in research for mass spectrometry, and the whole reason for their research is to try and further and better understand the technique of mass spectrometry. But basically, they existed in research or in confirmatory types of environments, and most chromatographers would never actually get to see them or even potentially even meet some of the people that operate them. The software itself was tended to be done on dedicated workstations, so on a computer that was by the side of the instrument, where they would acquire the data, work with the data, analyze it, or potentially they would physically move that data across to another machine, another computer, where they would process it there. The instruments, as you can see from the picture, were pretty big, and the footprints of these often meant that they took up an entire room all to themselves. And as you can imagine, for something so big, the cost was often quite high as well. It was essentially, from a software point of view, quite a simple equation, really. If you were doing mass spec work, you were working within mass spec software. And if you were doing chromatography work, you would typically be working in a chromatography software or a CDS. But over the last couple of decades, that landscape has been evolving, as chromatography is starting to take on more and more mass spec detection. So I've got a brief history of mass spec devices in Empower, or if we go back to the beginning of this timeline in Millennium, as Empower used to be called. And it's over 20 years ago now that the Integrity system, which was an electron impact mass spec, came into the Empower pipeline and was started to be used by mass spectrometrists working with Empower. So at this stage, it's still very much a mass spec used by mass spec specialists. And over subsequent years, single quads were brought into that Empower family, where they were being controlled and the data being analyzed and used by people working within Empower system. And that all went all the way through to 2006, where a triple quad was introduced as well. All of these instruments really still are designed for use by a mass spec expert, or at least somebody who is well versed in mass spectrometry and understands the technique well. That kind of changed when the QDA was introduced by Waters, because this device was really aimed at a chromatographer. So, whereas previously the expectation was that the person using the instrument would have a significant amount of mass spec experience, with the QDA that was quite different. The assumption was that the person using it would be more likely to be a chromatographer without any real significant experience of mass spectrometry. Then in 2016, the SQD2 detector was introduced. And this is just goes to show that chromatography and mass spectrometry still exist together. It's not just about having a chromatography or a chromatographer-only mass spec or mass detector like the QDA. There's still room for more sophisticated mass specs in the chromatography world as well. So that brings us up to where we are with the current landscape. So this slide really shows that there really is quite a broad range of different instruments and different uses of those instruments within the chromatography lab and within labs in general, analytical labs in general. There are still specialists working in specialized research labs, working on these sophisticated and, let's say, slightly higher priced mass spec devices. But there are also some of the more, say, smaller, in this case, smaller footprint devices that have been bought in to use by chromatographers and chromatographers that have developed mass spec skills into the development labs. And really, with the advent of the QDA, they're starting to become available to QC labs as well. And as you can imagine, in research, development, and the routine environments, there's a big range of skill sets involved there, so that the analysts involved wouldn't necessarily all have exactly the same skill sets, and they would have different expectations from these instruments. The other big change that's come about in the current landscape is that with a chromatography data system, quite often you're working in a networked environment where the data is stored centrally and lots of people, maybe even a few thousand people, have access to the same chromatography data system. Mass specs bring along with it quite a lot of data, in much the same way that when photodiode array instruments were brought in to a chromatography data system, when compared to a UV, the amount of data increased. When mass detection comes in, the amount of data goes up as well. So being able to deal with that data becomes much more critical, and being able to get to the data you need becomes important. And today, with the chromatography world, obviously there's the chromatography software, the CDS. But there's still a requirement in some places to have dedicated MS software as well, depending on the type of instrument. So there's a bit of a mismatch, or sorry, not mismatch, but there's a bit of a combination of different software that is available to chromatographers today. And as these devices have become more powerful, they've also become more compact. So now, even and with a very small footprint of the QDA, it still packs quite a punch with regard to mass spectrometry. And with those smaller footprints comes a reduced cost in ownership and cost in initial purchase. And some of the reasons for these devices becoming more prevalent as we go into development and into the routine is possibly down to the reduced cost and footprint as well, because demands on space and finances become more significant. So really, what does all this mean for the chromatographer? So as I said, mass detection is playing a much broader role in today's labs. Mass specs are still very much present in research, development, and becoming more prevalent in the routine labs, where they're reaching a high or a wide range of skills. The expectations and the requirements of mass spectation by these different individuals does mean that there's quite a stress on what needs to be done. So what does all this really mean? Well, I put together a bit of analogy here with scuba diving. At the top, we can see a picture of Jacques Cousteau. If those of you that are familiar with diving will probably recognize him. Jacques Cousteau was one of the founding fathers of scuba diving, and he did an awful lot of research into that field. And today, there are still other divers and researchers doing exactly the same thing. They're really trying to push the boundaries of what is possible with the thing that they do. The picture in the middle is a picture of a technical diver. And this is somebody that has an awful lot of requirements for kit, does an awful lot of demanding work, and is trying to do things that maybe other divers don't do. They're often trying to go deeper or dive for longer or do various things that are really pushing their understanding of that particular activity. So they have to be very highly trained, and they have to do things regularly to keep up that training and that understanding. And then at the bottom of this particular slide, we have a couple of holiday divers. So these might be divers that go and interact and go and dive maybe once a year while they're on holiday, maybe not even once a year, maybe just a few times in their lives they might go diving. So they're just occasional users of the diving equipment. And as you can see from the picture, the amount of equipment they need is very, very different to the amount that the technical diver in the middle has. So if we bring that back to mass spectrometry, a researcher is going to have very, very different set of skills, requirements, and expectations to a technical diver. And they will have, again, a very, very different set of expectations to somebody that just interacts just occasionally with mass spectrometry. So we have to be able to try and cater to all of the demands of these people by providing what they need when they need it. So what does that actually mean to a chromatographer? Well, if you're one of the researchers or if you are a dedicated LC-MS user, your requirements may be that you need a full and in-depth access to mass spectrometry data. You might expect to be able to interact with the software and to be able to get directly into the data exactly when you need it to find what you need and be able to drill down into the details to get to what you need. Whereas somebody who is a more of a frequent MS user, maybe they come from an MS background and they're working within a chromatography environment. They have to have a very good understanding of the MS data, but it's possible that where they're working is more of a subset of that full data set, because they already have a very good idea of exactly what is needed and what they need to do. We then go down to the occasional user. So this is the sort of person that might go diving as a hobby or use the mass spec as and when it's needed. Things may be laid out much more clearly in methods for them to follow, so they'd have a limited set of data and they basically know what they need, but they still have to have a reasonable understanding of what the MS data is. And then there's the last type, which, to be honest, when I was working in the lab, this is how I would have described myself. It's just another detector. It's just data. And the method that I'm using describes exactly what I need to do and what I need to get out of it. So all I want to be presented with when I'm using that particular device is exactly what I need and no more. So as we can see, there's quite a broad scope of what needs to be done here. So if we have a little look at those two directions, if we have a non-MS user coming into the world of chromatography or living in the world of chromatography and trying to see how a mass spec or a mass detector is going to affect them, and then the next slide will deal with it the other way around, where maybe somebody who is very familiar with mass spectrometry is coming into more of a chromatography environment. So as a chromatographer, I was very used to the single wavelength UV detector. It was my bread and butter. It's what I used to use on a daily basis. But every now and again, I would need to investigate a little bit more, and that's when the diode array would come in useful to me. So I would use the UV detector as and when I needed it and then move on to the diode array. So when Waters were designing the QDA and when Waters were looking at how we should have M-Power interact with the QDA, we were basically coming from what if that extended out again to a mass detector. So this is really there for those people like myself who look at this as another set of data. They're not expert users in mass spectrometry. They don't really have the time to deal with all of the maintenance or some of the maintenance that is associated with some of the more sophisticated mass specs. They just simply want to walk up to it, switch it on, use it, and when they're done, switch it off, just like they do with the diode array. And what effectively this does is, if I can take the increase in information that I have from a single wavelength UV, take that up to a photodiode array where I get much richer information and a much allows me to do more decision making, but acquiring in the same run. If I can then put a mass detector on that, I can then start to get mass data for the same run, for the same data. And that just gives me more confidence in the information that I'm doing, allows me to make better decisions on the data that I've got. So we're really saying that as a chromatographer, it's a natural extension for me to use a mass detector that is designed to be used just like the instruments that I'm familiar with, such as the UV and the diode array. But if I was coming from the other direction, if I was a mass spec user that is now living in the world of chromatography a lot more. So here we have our SQT2 detector, which is a single quad detector and is really designed for existing MS users. It does have advantages over the QDA detector. It does have, for example, multiple sources, higher sensitivity. It's also got increased mass range as well. So that is something where I'm coming from, or where somebody might be coming from as an existing MS user, but I might want to be able to get my methods to somebody who isn't. So having the ability to take my existing knowledge as a mass spectrometrist and apply that to a detector that allows other people who aren't mass spectrometrists to use allows that transition. So I could, in other words, maybe transfer methods that I'm developing on my mass spec to a QDA, or maybe, depending on the compounds that I have and where I am, my knowledge of that data, those compounds, is I could actually take the QDA to start with, or this mass detector to start with, and develop methods directly on that. And effectively what that's doing is that's providing me with more confidence in the data that I'm producing. There's one thing that one customer at one time said to me was that whenever they're developing a method, they wouldn't want to use an instrument that can't then be used by the people that are going to use that method. So they would want to develop on the instrument that is going to be available in the lab for those people that are using that data. So being able to develop, say, for example, on a mass detector like the QDA would give them the confidence that they've developed that right method, and also the confidence that that is going to be suitable and useful to those people that are going to use it down the line. So very much the same way that a photodiode array gives more confidence over a single wavelength, mass detection gives added or provides another layer of confidence for that particular user or that method development or whatever it happens to be. So some of the areas where I can see as a chromatographer, I can see that I might be interested in getting a little bit more confidence in my data would be things like method development. So peak tracking using MS as opposed to photodiode array and UV spectra. Maybe peak purity, giving me a little bit more confidence about convolution of peaks. But also, and one of the things I used to spend a lot of time doing was working within stability and getting to understand what those tiny peaks were. Had I seen them before? Was it the same that I saw in the last impurity profile that I did, and so on? And having more information about them would have been very useful to me. But even going down to simple things like identification might have been useful to say, this is this mass, therefore it is what I think it is. Cleaning validation, or just doing simple cleaning methods, running cleaning methods on reaction vessels and so on. And all of this is really there as a complement to the UV data that the chromatographer is familiar with. And it allows the chromatographer to look at that data with the same eyes that they've always done, so they can still look at their UV data and just get more benefit from it with the added mass information that's on there. So if we just have a look at some of these in a little bit more detail. So if I'm doing some sort of method development, I might want to track my peak across different method conditions, different instrument method conditions. So as we know, when we're doing method development, we want to alter the instrument conditions. And as we do that from one injection to the next, the peaks will probably move. In many cases, we hope that they do move because that's the whole purpose of us doing that method development, to see how the different conditions affect the chromatography. But in addition to moving, their shape might change, their height, their area could also change. And in some cases, even the UV spectra may change from one set of conditions to another. For example, if the pH changes, then the UV spectra could be affected by that, and it could actually look different. But if you were able to have mass data, and you were able to assign or have a mass automatically assigned, and being able to track those peaks using that assigned mass, that may allow for much better and faster method development. And if, as a chromatographer, you were looking at a UV chromatogram and you were able to see the assigned masses just appearing as a label on those peaks, I can then see how those peaks move around as I'm looking at the different chromatograms within my run. So if we just zoom in on this table a little bit, so seeing the chromatograms is one way of seeing how peaks can move around. Another way is to put a table together. And I can see here on the table, on the column headers, I'm just basically saying, these are the assigned masses that have been detected in the runs that I've done. And below are the different instrument methods, and the rows in each of the columns refer to the retention time. So this is essentially a table that is the retention time summarized by the assigned mass. And as a chromatographer, at this stage, I'm really not looking at any mass spec or any of the intricacies of mass spec at all. I'm really just looking at my UV chromatogram and a table of data. So from here, I can see that maybe on the peak at the beginning, it's always staying at the beginning in this example, and it's not moving around much. That's the one at 286. And then there's another one that is maybe moving around a little bit more, like this one at 182, that is moving around a bit more. And in the example that we can see here, those peaks are often very similar sizes. And it's possible that they're also very similar UV spectra, because they might be related to each other. So using UV alone is going to get me so far. Using photodiode array is going to get me further. But using mass spec is going to give me that extra confidence that would really help me identify how those peaks are moving around. And by doing it in this way, it allows me, without really much in the way of MS training at all, just to be able to track those peaks by simply labeling them or putting them into a table. Another useful thing that method developers need to know is, do I have any coelutions of peaks? And if I do, where are they? Because next time I can maybe change the method to try and extract those out from each other. So one thing we can do is we can use UV for this, but again, UV, if those peaks that are coeluting are very, very similar, especially in the area of their chromophore, then by trying to identify the different spectra may become quite tricky, quite difficult. Whereas if I had a mass and the compound had actually changed, but away from that chromophore, so the UV spectra is going to be similar, the mass is still going to be quite different. So I can use this to see what's on the tailing edge, what's on the apex, and what's on the leading edge of the peak, and just to have a quick look at those mass spectra, just to see whether or not there's any changes. And if I wasn't that familiar with mass spec, I can just see what the mass was at the leading, the apex and the tailing, just to see if there's large differences there, which would help me determine whether or not I've got any coelution going on. and sometimes we may want to see that UV spectra and that mass spectra together. So within the Empower screen, that's also possible. In this case, I've just used it to highlight something with regard to the impurities here. So if I was working on something and I found a very small peak, in this case, the peak that's been identified at with a mass of 210 isn't actually that small. It's quite a reasonably sized peak. It's even visible when you're looking at it at this increased scale. But if I was going to a much, much smaller peak, which could have a very poor chromophore at such low amounts, trying to find that UV spectra and differentiate it from one run to another, when those runs could be 3 months apart, have I found this before? Is it the same peak that I had 3 months ago to what I'm seeing now? Being able to look at a UV spectra as well as the MS spectra is going to give me that added confidence that maybe I've seen this peak before or not. I think it's worth pointing out at this stage that we really are talking about single quad data, so this isn't definitive. But when we're looking at compounds for method development, and when we're looking in the realms of development as opposed to research, we have a reasonably good idea of what our data is, what our components are within any mixture. So it's not as if we've got brand new things coming at us. But even if we did have brand new things, this would give a hint to those things that are coming, and then maybe we can pass those on to, let's say, a different type of instrument, a different technique, or a mass spec with higher resolution or something. So the idea of this is really for the chromatographer to be able to use those that mass data to increase the confidence of what they're seeing and how they're using their systems. And the final one is maybe slightly more obvious without the use of mass spec. But again, it's just all about the use of, or the idea of creating more confidence in your data. I've just got a made-up chromatogram here with some names on the peaks. And if, when I was working in the lab, it might be that I had an established method. I just had to look to see if the peak or peaks were appearing in my chromatogram at basically the same retention time as they did in the method. If they did, then I would just say this is the right peak. Being able to put this mass against those peaks just gives me that added confidence. And again, in this case, all I'm doing is I'm just seeing the mass above the peak name, just not even looking at the UV spectra or the MS spectra. I'm just looking at the UV chromatogram, and I'm seeing some mass information there. So from this point of view, I as a routine analyst would have just walked up to the instrument, switched it all on, started my run, acquired my data, looked at this, just made sure that the peak Sylvia was indeed at 182 mass, and then I'm happy that I've made a correct identification. And all of that is done using effectively the techniques that are familiar to existing chromatographers with very little requirement in the way of training. Then if we move on to cleaning validation, in some ways, you really want to prove that you can't see anything at all. So you want to prove that the vessel that you've been mixing something up in and then emptied and now are cleaning, you want to make sure that all of that something that was there is no longer there. So this is trying to look at very, very small amounts of things, very, very small amounts of those drugs or those pesticides or those whatever it was that you were making in that vessel before. And you've got to be absolutely sure that it's clean. So by being able to either identify peaks because of, for some components, the mass spec may have higher sensitivity, you can also say, but if there is a peak there, I can start to put a mass to it and then maybe identify what isn't being cleaned sufficiently and whether or not that's going to cause me an issue moving on. So in this case, it's more of a, can I prove that there is something not there rather than trying to detect something that is. Effectively, all of that is done pretty much as a complementary method to to the UV data. So I'm going to move on to the question now as to what is the role of the software and what should our expectations be for that software? Well, I guess it's fairly obvious in many ways what the software is and what it does. It should interface with the instrument. It should allow data to be acquired from that instrument. You should be able to process that data, get your results out, and report it. Obviously, all of that is very, very important, and it has to do it. But I actually think how it does it is possibly more important than what it does. Because if the features and the functions are there, but they're not available at the appropriate or not available in a way that is appropriate to the user that needs it, then there could potentially be a problem. So I've used a sort of another analogy here of a buffet. Now, it's very, very important that we acquire that data, and it's very important that data is there in its entirety. But how do we know what we need? And how do we make sure that we have everything we need, but we don't have any more, and we don't have any less? How can we ensure that we have what we need when we need it, and how we need it as well? It could be that having the entire buffet is very, very good, but maybe I just want a sandwich. So if we go back to these different roles that I put forward at the beginning. So we may have our researchers, we may have our frequent users of the system, and we may have our occasional users of the system. So how much is enough? Well, that's not for me to determine. That will vary massively depending on whether you are the researcher or whether you are the frequent user or the occasional user or that person for whom it's just a detector. So will one solution fit all? Or do you have to tailor that solution so that it provides what is required when it's required? And will those, what is needed, change from time to time? So for example, in my little diving analogy, I may be a technical diver, but I just want to go on holiday. So do I need to take all of that technical diving equipment with me? Or can I just strip it right down and jump in the sea with just that stripped down equipment and just do what I need? Because if I was going on doing a normal experiment, do I really want to have to dig through everything, find what I need, then process it all at a later date? Or do I just want to get to where I want to go as quickly as possible? So if we take this to the buffet example, as a researcher, I might want to say, well, I've got the full buffet there, and I want to be able to decide what I need and when I need it. It could be that what I need to do is I need to go to a certain part of the buffet, pick different parts up, and that will then take me to other areas where I need to investigate. So if I went to the salad section, I could choose my salad and then determine that actually I now need to go to the salad dressing because that's led me down that route and I need to go to that part. And as a researcher, I'm going to be very, very familiar with how that buffet is laid out. So I know exactly where to go. I know exactly what I need to do and where to go after that and pick those things. So having the full buffet there is an advantage for me. It doesn't hinder me at all. But it could be, as a frequent user of the system, I may want to go to that one section that I need to work in. Let's say I just want a sandwich. So I want to go to that one section, but I want to better decide what the fillings are for that sandwich and how I want it made, what the bread's going to be, and all that sort of thing. So I just want to go there, and then I want to work in that environment. So when I look at the buffet, I don't want to see everything. I just want to see the sandwich section. But if I'm one of those people for whom it's just a detector or I'm a very infrequent user, I just want to go for that one sandwich. I know the one I need. I just want to walk straight up to it and get the one that I want. So all of these things are, they're going to be different. from one person to the next. Every time they walk up to the system, they may also change how they want to interact with that system as well. So where does that take us really in the future? In many ways, I really don't think we need a crystal ball. We've seen what's happened with the photodiode array as that came into the labs, increased that level of confidence in the data as we were analyzing it. We know that mass detection is coming. In many cases, mass detection in a chromatography lab is already there. In the last few years, it's moving from being a tool for a mass spec person in a chromatographer's world to being just another detector, depending on what you want to do with it. We also know that there is more and more data coming with this. There is more and more information that has to be taken out of that data. And as I'm sure everybody listening will be able to attest to, there is less and less time for us to be able to do that. So the future really comes down to what the skill sets are, what the requirements are, and what the expectations are. And really, in the future, we have to be able to say the researchers can go into what they need to see. They still have to be able to go in and look at the full data set, understand what they're doing, be able to drill down into those details, and have it presented to them in a way that they understand. Also, those frequent users have to be able to do what they want to do, exactly when they want to do it. And possibly because this last bit is in many ways the most important bit, because it affects the most people, is that if it's just another detector, all I want to do is to be able to walk up to it, switch it on, run it, analyze my results, maybe just by looking at a report or just by looking at what I'm familiar looking at, which is just a UV chromatogram, and then just saying, I have what I need, I can now move on to the next thing. So in many cases, the future is exactly the same as it is today. I think the challenge is that how do we make sure that each of those individuals or each of those individual roles gets what they require out of the software exactly when they need it. So really it is to say, we have to be able to fine-tune the buffet so that people can get to what they need when they need it, so that it meets their skill sets and it meets all of their requirements and their expectations at the point when they're expecting it. Which basically, if I take some of these much more sophisticated MS methods that are out there today, such as something like the more sophisticated instruments like the Synapse, for example, that does something called collision cross-section, to be honest. As a chromatographer, I'm not that sure exactly what all that stuff means. I have other skill sets and other ways and other jobs that I need to do. But what I do know is that value could give me a lot more confidence in the thing that I'm doing. So even if I just didn't know what that was all about particularly, if that information was presented to me in a way that was suitable and appropriate for my needs, then I would simply be able to use that type of data just as a mass spec specialist would. Now, if I wanted to delve in and dive right into that data, find out more about it, then sure, I would have to go and learn a new skill. Or I could simply say to one of my colleagues, can you explain this to me? Can you take this away and work with this yourself? So it really is a matter of saying, how is the future going to be? Well, personally, I think MS is going to become far more accessible to a lot more people. But by doing that, it also has to be done in a way that is appropriate to what their expectations are and how they're going to use that system and use that knowledge and present that data. So that's the end of my presentation. I'd like to thank you all very much, and I'd like to hand it back to Laura.
Thank you very much, David, for that excellent talk. It's now time for questions from the audience. So I just want to remind all of you that how to submit a question. You can do that by typing it in the Q&A box, and you can find that on the right-hand side of your presentation window. Okay, first question, David. How can I change AU to MAU in Empower?
Well, that's a very specific question about Empower. Maybe that's something that if you'd like to contact us directly, we can take you through that.
Perfect. We can do that. Thank you. So let's go to then kind of the opposite, a much broader question. So where do you see the main use of mass detection in chromatography labs?
Yeah, that's in some ways, I would say that going forwards into the future, I think that that's going to become much more prevalent in the routine world. And I think that basically mass spectrometry is going to be, because of its increased specificity and because it's becoming much more available to more and more people, I really see that there are no places where it won't go in many ways. That with the added fact that the cost of it is coming down, and it's not just the cost of the ownership, the initial purchase, it's the cost of the ownership as well. So it's really becoming just like a photodiode array. So wherever you see a photodiode array today, I can imagine the use of MS in that area. And I can also see that when we start to make more demands from our mass spec data, there will be new instruments coming through that allow somebody who doesn't necessarily dedicate their lives to mass spec to be able to use those as a mass detector and get much more sophisticated data out of it. Now, of course, in order to do that, the software has to enable that user to interact at a level that is appropriate for them. So I think that is one of the bigger challenges that we have, is to make sure that we can get the data presented, the instrument control suitable, so that people can just walk up to it, use it just as they would do any other chromatographic detector, look at the data, and then work with it. So I think some of the areas that we touched on in the presentation there, such as method development, there are some very, very obvious uses for it in method development. But I really think that it goes an awful lot further than that. And it should start to come into more mainstream use just to add that level of confidence. So it comes down to the amount of confidence you need in your data. If you feel that by adding more confidence is going to allow you to be more productive, or it's going to allow you to answer questions that you weren't able to answer before, or it's going to give you more of a robust answer to anything that comes out of a regulatory type of question, then I really see that's where it's going to go in the future.
Excellent. So then if we kind of drill down on that a little bit, for what types of analysis do you see mass detection providing the biggest benefits?
Yeah, so I think if you're looking at things where they start to challenge the UV data. So there are certain compounds where, let's say, if you're doing a related substances analysis, by definition, those compounds are related to each other. And if they're related to each other, then their chromophore may be very, very similar, if not the same. So when you see that type of an analysis going on, when the UV or even the photodiode array is starting to be pushed to how accurate it can be or how discriminating it can be between the peaks, then that's the type of analysis that I see, or I would expect that the mass spectrometry giving a huge amount of value. And also there are certain elements where you have a matrix of different compounds, such as maybe environmental or somewhere like that, where mass spectrometry is already being used quite a lot today. The idea that it's no longer going to be the remit of those few MS specialists, but it can now go into a much more general environment and allow people to use those in a much broader way, I think it's all those sorts of analysis where we can start to see the MS or mass detection coming to the fore.
Can these simpler mass detectors be used for methods such as peptide mapping?
I think it all depends on, I guess, the charge to mass ratio of the and the size of those peptides. The simpler, the for example, the QDA, I confess I'm not an expert in the QDA, but I think it has a mass range of around, I think it's 1,250. So it all depends on the mass to charge ratio and how you can bring that that to your advantage to bring it within that mass range of that detector. The single quads would tend to have a mass range which would be twice that or more than twice that. So depending on the level of how familiar the analysts are with the mass detectors, it could be that something like the SQD2 might be more appropriate. But then it depends on the compounds that you're using. But it also isn't just a limit of the mass spec itself or the mass detector itself. It also comes down to how will the software allow you to interpret that data better.
Do you see mass detection as a complementary technique to UV or as a standalone for use without UV?
Yeah, well, I think that certainly right now it's very much a complementary detector. And as a chromatographer, I'm personally much more comfortable, much more familiar looking at a UV chromatogram. Now, that UV chromatogram can be augmented with mass data, just like we saw with the mass label on the peak. But I'm still, as a chromatographer, looking at my UV data. And then I'm getting more information from the mass spec side of things. But so right now, I would say that it's very much a complementary technique. I think that could all change. And, you know, it's very difficult to sort of see whether or not that will change. But I suspect that it will. And I suspect that as people then start to become more used to just looking at maybe a mass chromatogram as opposed to a UV chromatogram, then they may well want to just use that mass detector by itself and not be complementary to anything else. But of course, it does depend on the compounds. So if that particular compound doesn't ionize, then you would need a complementary detector. So you would need a UV or something. But of course, then the same could be true if you were looking at a sample that doesn't have a chromophore or a strong chromophore. Then the mass detector could give you that information. So right now I see it as a complementary detection method, but who knows where the future will go.
Let's do perhaps one or two more. Is there a tutorial demo for Empower to demonstrate how the mass of a peak can be identified?
That's something that we will be very happy to show anybody that wanted to see it. I think because we could certainly do something in a very sort of simple way, but people are going to have lots of different requirements for mass detection. They want to see it in a different way or just simply have a different set of needs. So a good way of doing that would be to contact the local waters people where you are and just sort of see if you can get them to come and do a demo or pop up and have a chat to them about it, and just to see if it does actually do what you want it to do. So I would recommend contacting the local waters guys in your area for that sort of information.
Perfect. All right, well, I think we'll wrap up. David, thank you so much for your talk and for answering those questions.
Thank you very much, and thank you everybody for being on the line and listening for the last hour.
I also would like to thank our sponsor, Waters, for making today's webcast possible. For all of you in the audience, please note that a brief survey will appear on your screen at the conclusion of today's webcast, and we hope that you'll participate in it. This webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through April of next year. You'll receive an email from LCGC alerting you when the webcast is available for replay. We invite you to forward that announcement to your colleagues who might have missed today's live event. We hope to see you all next time. Goodbye.